How cells use DNA to make proteins, suggesting the genetic code is more diverse than previously thought. Cells take a number of complicated steps to translate the sequence of basic DNA building blocks into proteins, which then act as workhorses to carry out the wider functions of life. So it's a quite, you know, it's a very complex phenomena as such. Okay, then I come to make some in-depth detail of the functioning of a cell. So, for deciphering the mysteries of a cell. Okay, a cell is the basic building block of all living things, right? So, you can define as cells are basic units of living organisms, and cells have all the equipment and expertise necessary to carry out the functions of life. So, you can eat, grow, move. It can perform necessary maintenance, recycle, and dispose of waste. It can adapt to changes in the environment, and so on. So, in this sense, it is a full, complete entity in terms of engineering and chemical engineering and industrial chemistry. We say that a cell is like a plant, a chemical plant, where all the processes are going on, are being carried out. And it is self-contained and self-sustained. Whereas the size of a cell is, we'll come to that, 1/10 or less than that of the tip of our hair. So here this is a typically a cell surrounded by a cell membrane, and these are the specific proteins which assist in the transport of nutrients, molecules from outside the cell to inside the cell until outside the cell. And these protein molecules are very specific. They work as a gatekeeper. They allow some molecules to enter, while some other molecules to exit, while they don't allow others. They're just like a gatekeeper. Typically, composition of a cell is 70% water and 30% chemical. That's why our body, our composition of our body is almost 70% is water. So now you can see the scale of these entities. So atom is of this size, 0.2 nanometer. Nanometer is 10 to the power minus 10 meters. 10 to the power minus 10 meters. And this is the DNA, cell nucleus, red blood cell, your RBCs are 6 microns. Blood cell, human hair is here, 1000 micron, and so you can say that our cell is of this. This is 100 micron is the human hair tip, and cell 6 micron is the, so it is more than 1/10 of the tip of the cell. Such a small entity, and the so many processes are going on in that. According to biochemists, more than 1000 enzymatic reactions occur in a cell. More than 1000. And out of this 1000, only few reaction mechanisms have been somewhat understood. Other mechanisms not understood at all. Despite all the researches world over in the field of biochemistry and cell biology until then. So these are, you know, how this like plants itself, how they tap the sun energy and then produce the nutrients out of that, of course. Then it is also very fascinating to know how the cells turn nutrients into energy. How like our body basically like we eat, right? It's a nutrient. And then with metabolic reaction, it is converted into energy which we use in our body, in our functioning of the body, right? So this is actually occurring at the cellular level, right? The nutrients are absorbed and then finally it goes to the cell, and there this transformation is taking place. And this is very interesting that the transformation of the nutrients the glucose from the nutrients transform to, I mean, to energy with this reaction, sugar plus oxygen gives CO2, carbon dioxide, water. That occurs in steps. The transformation is not one big jump, but it is in steps. And that way it conserves the energy. Those energy evolve at those steps, they are stored in molecules. And that's why the energy transformation, generation, storage and utilization in the cell is most efficient. It is the one of the most efficient energy utilization system known to human beings. So there are some of the details, I just skip that. So basically these are the molecules called ATP and NADH, which are the energy storage and carrier. So these are the molecules which store the energy, and whenever required, they just by hydrolysis reaction they deliver the energy. So these are some of the technical details. Like I was talking of enzymes, the more than 1000 enzymatic reaction. These enzymes are molecules, protein molecules, which essentially assist in the reaction and combine the two nutrients to give the energy and another nutrient. So this reaction is aided by the enzymes. Either enzyme can trigger a reaction, or it can inhibit a reaction, or it can accelerate the reaction, or it can degrade the rate of reaction. So this is the mechanism. I think we can skip to that. Basically, this assists the reaction by decreasing what you call as the activation energy. Activation energy is sort of barrier, you know. So there is a hill. Somebody wants to go to the other side. So the higher the hill, the more efforts it has to try to go to the other side. Isn't it? So this enzyme molecule, they decrease that level of barrier. So that the molecule can easily jump and combine to form the product. That's how the mechanism in these energies are stored here in this phosphate chain. You know? These bonds are very high energy bonds. Basically, energy is stored in form of this chemical bond. And once hydrolysis reaction occurs, these bonds are broken and enormous energy is available for performing other metabolic activities. Then, you know, these are some of the scientific facts. Those who are have interest can, you know, go through this. I will give you, I think, yeah, I should now stop in under 5-10 minutes. I will come to show some interesting, you know, phenomena in cell. As I told you, cell membranes serve a barrier and gatekeepers. So they allow passage of some molecules which are required as a nutrient, while they don't allow other molecules to go in. They allow some molecules to skip out of the cell, which should come out, which are the product of the reaction, while those which are utilized during the reaction are not allowed to skip out. So this shows the selective transport across cell membrane. We'll come to a little bit more interesting diagram on this. Yeah. So this is the basic principle of, you know, diffusion. Diffusion means transport of some molecule from one place to the other place. So usually diffusion, the mass diffusion is by virtue of concentration difference. For example, we have a perfume, right? You have a perfume bottle. You open the perfume bottle, what will happen? The perfume molecules will diffuse in the atmosphere, so everybody can feel the, you know, sense of perfume, right? Similarly, if you put the tea bag in a cup of water, you see that in hot water the tea particles will diffuse. The reason is that the tea is very concentrated in the tea bag, where in the water its concentration is low. So just it's a spontaneous process. Because of the concentration difference, the particle will diffuse from the tea bag to the water. Similarly, the particle of perfume will diffuse from the perfume bottle to the surroundings. So this is an instantaneous process. You don't have to do anything. It will occur by itself. Right? But so this is called classic diffusion. So the diffusion due to the temperature, the concentration difference is called passive diffusion. However, and then of course in the cell membranes, even this passive diffusion is not possible for all the molecules. So this diffusion is only allowed for some specific molecules through this tube-shaped transmembrane protein channel. So this protein channel has specific affinity, a specific love for some molecules, for them they allow to enter, for others they do not. Okay? Despite the concentration difference. While another is facilitated diffusion. In facilitated diffusion, basically, this transmembrane protein act as a carrier. They do the sharing. So they go on the one side, they combine with the molecule, make a complex, travel through the membrane, and then at the other side, the complex breaks and delivers the molecule. So they are just like ferrying. If they are parking, they go one side, take the passenger, go other side, and they drop on the other side of the pan, right? So they do this ferrying, so this is called facilitated diffusion. And the third is very interesting thing is active transport. Active transport is against the concentration barrier. So this is from low concentration to high concentration. And this is not a spontaneous process. That's why for this it requires energy. And that energy is provided by these ATP molecules and NADH. So it is something against the concentration barrier. And this is very unique to this cell system. This is a unique process for the cell system. And it's all occurring by itself. And this whole phenomena is designed like that. And this is what Qudratullah is. There is no human intervention at this level at all. It is not possible. If you want to manipulate it, you cannot. This is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which has created this whole system and maintained the system. So all these things give a sort of insight of that ayah. If you start studying these principles and deciphering the principles and writing the principles, so indeed it shows that the seed will exhaust, the tree will exhaust, but this Allah, which has Allah's words, will not exhaust, will not finish. So this is a very interesting thing that you can see from a low concentration here, these green molecules, they are transferred to on this side. Whereas these yellow molecules on low concentration going to the other side. This is also one interesting system in the cellular mechanism. That is what they call as the sodium potassium pump. That transports sodium ions out of the cell and potassium ions in with driving force provided by ATP hydrolysis. Then in this case also in the transport, some of the transport is slow because the concentration gradient is not that large. Then again the ATP provides energy to enhance the rate of transport. So that is also another mechanism. So I think all this shows, this is just one example. Now, only from the cellular metabolism, there can be such lectures can be delivered on other topics. What I talk is, what is the cell? What are the essential characteristics of the cell? Then, how do cells decode genetic information into functional protein? How are eukaryotic cells organized into smaller parts? How do cells sense their environment? How do cells know when to divide? And so on. So, there can be lectures of ours together on this topic. This is just for a cell. Then what we talk about all this cosmic world, all the heavenly bodies, all the Allah's creation under the earth and under the seas, and so on. So this what gives some idea, right? That how vast is the knowledge of Allah, how vast is the words of Allah. And that gives an idea what this Kalimat Rabbi and Kalimat Allah means in those ayat. And After all this, what Allah says, وَمَا أُوْتِيكُمْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. What we have been given, what knowledge we have been given, what we have been able to show and bring about from this knowledge is very little compared to the whole knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that ultimately इसमें दावत का जो पहलू है इसमें तो यही है कि विद ऑल दिस यू हैव नो ऑप्शन बट टू सरेंडर टू द वननेस ऑफ अल्लाह एंड ग्रेटनेस ऑफ अल्लाह एंड बिकम एन ओबीडिएंट सर्वेंट टू अल्लाह सो दैट यू नो यू गेट सक्सेस इन दिस वर्ल्ड एंड द हियर आफ्टर. सो दीज आर सम ऑफ द रेफरेंसेस व्हिच हैव बीन यूज्ड टू प्रिपेयर दिस मटेरियल. So with this, I end my talk here.
So, I'm going to ask some questions.